Well, as Lisa said, we miss you guys being here in person. We can't wait to see you October the 18th. I think we're going to get together, so we're looking forward to that time when we can actually see you and worship with you face to face. We love all you guys, and we want you to know we pray for you every day. You know, I want to talk to you tonight about the importance of bearing fruit. We're going to look at two passages, basically, out of John 15 and Galatians 5, and I'm going to use mostly the Passion Translation tonight. So the importance of bearing fruit, I know this is something that, you know what, it's helped me, and you know, I know it's going to help you as well. Before we start, let me just pray. Father, we just thank you for this opportunity to get together and to worship you and to open your word, Lord, and we just thank you for this opportunity, Father. Lord, we just pray right now, Father, that you would just prepare our hearts. Like little children, Father, we sit before you and we ask you to teach us. Lord, as the men on the road to Emmaus, we pray, Father, that our hearts would burn within us tonight as we hear your word taught and preached, Father. We pray that, Father, that you would open the eyes of our understanding so that we would know exactly what you'd have us to know, Father. Father, bless, as Lisa prayed, bless everyone within the sound of my voice. Father, you know what they're going through. I don't know what they're going through, but you do because you're a good shepherd. Touch, heal, encourage, strengthen, deliver. Father, comfort, whatever they need right now, Father, they would just feel your presence. Lord, like the lady with the issue of blood that reached out in faith and touched the hem of your garment, they reach out right now and touch in faith the hem of your garment, and you do whatever they need to be done, Father. Settle our hearts, settle our minds, Father, as we open your word in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You know, one thing I've noticed that when I'm with people that have been following Jesus for a long time, very often they have many of the same qualities and characteristics. I'm talking about people who've allowed Jesus to work in their lives, to mold them and make them into who he wants them to be. People who have allowed the Holy Spirit to do an internal work in their lives. People who are being transformed into the image of Jesus. I think about my friend Ben. You know, we went to the same high school. I knew of his reputation. He was part of a motorcycle gang even back then. He hung around a tough crowd. He was rough, he was tough, he was mean, he was violent. He cursed like a sailor. And you know, he had already, even at that young age, 17 or 18 years of age, he'd been in trouble with the law. But many years ago, Ben had a real encounter with Jesus. And you know what? His life was radically changed. And over the past 40 years, almost 40 years, Ben has allowed God to mold him and to make him into who he wants him to be. He's allowed the Holy Spirit to do a deep internal work in his life, in his character. Now Ben is a totally different person. Not long ago, I asked Ben's wife to describe Ben as she saw him now. She used phrases like, he's a man of great love. He has unending patience and understanding. He's quick to forgive and always looks for opportunities to encourage. He brings joy and strength into our family. He has great self-control, especially in tough situations, and he's known for his gentleness. As a matter of fact, his nickname now is Gentle Ben. Think about that. A rough, tough man like Ben was before, and now his nickname is Gentle Ben. You see, Ben, over the years, has allowed the Holy Spirit to work in his life. He's allowed Jesus to mold and make his character. He's been being transformed into the image of Jesus. Or put another way, Ben is bearing fruit. I think about my friend that we call Brother Dan. He's well into his 80s now, and he's been following Jesus for a long time, for over 50 years. And I know personally that Brother Dan's been through some very, very difficult times. Many years ago, he lost his wife after a long battle with cancer. Then several years later, he suddenly and tragically lost his son as well. But despite all that he's been through, when you meet Brother Dan, he is one of the most gentle and kind and loving and joy-filled people that you'll ever meet. He's always looking for ways to encourage and build you up. And even at his age, he continues to faithfully serve the Lord by ministering to those who've gone through grief and loss like he has. Several years ago, Brother Dan remarried, and I asked his wife, Shirley, about him. And she described him like this: he's so strong with an unwavering faith, but he's so patient with those that are weak. He's loving and gentle and kind and always loves to cheer people on in their walk with Jesus. You see, like Ben, Brother Dan has allowed the Holy Spirit to do a work in his life. He's allowed Jesus to mold him and make him into who he wants him to be, to mold his character. And he is being transformed into the image of Jesus. He too, like Ben, is bearing fruit. And that's what God wants for each and every one of us as his followers. Jesus said it like this in John 15, "I am the sprouting vine and you're my branches. As you live in union with me as your source." One translation says, "abide in me" or "remain in me." As you live in union with me as your source, fruitfulness will stream from within you. But when you live separated from me, you're powerless. When your lives bear abundant fruit, you demonstrate that you are my mature disciples who glorify my Father. From this passage, you can see that God wants each and every one of his followers to bear fruit. As a matter of fact, I'm going to say something like that's pretty bold, but I'm going to say it like this. Our highest goal as believers should be to grow and bear fruit. Our highest goal should be to grow and mature and make progress and to be more like Jesus in our character, in our conduct, in our thoughts, in our attitudes, and in our speech. When you think about it, when you think about a tree that bears fruit, it's a sign that that tree is healthy. It's a sign that that tree is growing. It's a sign that that tree is maturing. And in the same way, as followers of Jesus, when we bear fruit, it's a sign that we are spiritually healthy and strong. When we bear fruit, it's a sign that we're spiritually maturing. When we bear fruit, it's a sign that we're becoming more and more like Jesus. But the opposite is also true, friends. As followers of Jesus, if we're not bearing fruit, it means that we're not spiritually healthy and growing. It means we're not maturing. It means we're not becoming more and more like Jesus. Sadly, I know people that have been followers of Jesus for a long time, but they're not changing. They're not growing. They're not bearing fruit. They're still angry and impatient and unkind and hard and harsh. They've made no progress. But that's not what God wants us to do. He wants us all to make progress and to bear fruit. But what is fruit, you might ask? Paul, what are you talking about when you talk about fruit? I found this great definition that I'd like to work from. It says this, "Fruit is the visible expression of the invisible work that God is doing in our lives." Think about that. Fruit is the visible expression of the invisible work that God is doing in us. In Galatians 5, Paul says it like this. He says, "This fruit is the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit produced by the Holy Spirit within you." Notice it's something that the Holy Spirit produces. The fruit produced by the Holy Spirit within you is divine love in all its expressions, joy that overflows, peace that subdues, patience that endures, kindness in action, a life that's full of virtue, one translation says goodness, faith that prevails, gentleness of heart, and strength of spirit or self-control. You see, Paul says this, that we, each and every one of us, as followers of Jesus, we should be increasing in love. We should be increasing in the fruit of the Spirit, which is joy and peace and patience. We should all be growing in gentleness and self-control. Because you know what? It's a process that takes time, but we should all be bearing fruit. We'll never arrive. We'll never be perfect all the time. But the key is, are we making progress in our walk with Jesus? Are we bearing more and more fruit? Maybe it's time to take inventory. I like to do this myself. It's time to take inventory, assess our spiritual lives. Are we more patient this year than we were last year? Are we more loving this year than we were last year? Do we have more self-control than we did last year? The key is not that we've arrived, but the key is, are we making progress in our walk with Jesus? In this passage, Paul also discusses the acts of the sinful nature or the works of the flesh. Those words are interchangeable, the sinful nature and flesh. But Paul talks about the acts of the sinful nature. And he says this, the acts of the sinful nature are obvious. And he goes on to list them like this. He says the acts of the sinful nature are sexual immorality, lustful thoughts, pornography, chasing after things rather than chasing after God, manipulating others, hatred, resentment, temper tantrums, angry quarrels, loving your own opinion, envy, murder, addictions, wild parties, and things of the like. You see, what we should do in our Christian walk is we need to move from this after we're born again, looking like this and acting like this, more and more to looking and acting like this, bearing fruit. Really, what we need to do is we've been born again. We've been changed one time when we were born again. But you know, friends, we're also being changed. We're being changed even now. And this is called the process of transformation as we grow and mature and make progress. And we go from being controlled by our sinful nature and flesh to being controlled by the Spirit of God on the inside of us. And this is a process called the process of transformation or the process of sanctification. And it's interesting, there's a beautiful scripture in 2 Corinthians 3:18 that says, we are all being transformed more and more into His image. That word transformed comes from the word we use, metamorphosis, the same root word, metamorphosis. You think about that. In metamorphosis, an ugly old caterpillar goes inside of a cocoon. And in that chrysalis or that cocoon, you know, something on the inside changes in that caterpillar's life. And all of a sudden, a few weeks later, that cocoon opens up and out comes a beautiful butterfly. In the same way, Paul's saying there in being transformed in His image, we all start out kind of as an ugly caterpillar. You know, this is the way we start out. But all of a sudden, God begins to do an internal work in each and every one of our lives. And you know what? We emerge looking totally different as we've walked with Jesus over a period of months and years. We emerged looking totally different, like a beautiful butterfly, like people that look more and more like Jesus, like people that are being transformed into His image. Well, let me give you some practical thoughts on how to allow the Holy Spirit to produce fruit in your life. Practical thoughts on how to allow the Holy Spirit to produce fruit in your lives. The first thing I would encourage you to do is this: stay connected to the vine. Stay in that vital life union with Jesus. Just like a branch must draw its life from the vine, so too we have to draw our life from Jesus. This is a vital connection that without it, we will not bear fruit. A vital connection that is absolutely necessary for us to bear fruit. When we're vitally connected to Jesus, when we're abiding in Jesus, when we're remaining in Jesus, it means that we have a relationship with Him. It means we've surrendered our lives to Him. It means we're letting Him be the Lord of our lives. It means that we're giving Him first place in our lives. It means that we're dependent on Him, not just when we're in desperate need, but we're dependent on Him 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. I thought about as an example of this, astronauts on a spacewalk. You know, they're connected to oxygen by those long tubes. If they lose that connection, you know what? They will not survive. And in the same way, we have to see our relationship with Jesus as this vital connection. As His life flows into us, we grow and mature and bear fruit. But without this connection, you know what? We never bear fruit. He says it like this: apart from me, you can do nothing. Well, practically, you might say, Paul, what does that mean practically? Well, it means that we need to spend time with Jesus every day. It means we need to read His Word, be acquainted with His Word, meditate on His Word. We need to talk to Him all through the day. That's called prayer. We need to listen to that still, small voice on the inside when He speaks to us. We need to be obedient to whatever He asks us to do. We need to surrender our lives daily to Him, put Him first place in our life, and be dependent on Him all the time. See, that's how we are vitally and stay vitally connected to Jesus. But then the second thing, besides being vitally connected, the second thing, we need to allow the Holy Spirit to do the work. We cannot change ourselves. It isn't our willpower, it isn't our effort that produces fruit. It's us yielding to the Holy Spirit who does the work in us. It's depending on the power of the Holy Spirit to help us change. Remember, it's the fruit of the Spirit. It's not the fruit of our effort or the fruit of our willpower. It's the fruit of the Spirit. We can't do it alone. We need the power of the Holy Spirit inside of us to change. I love the way Peter puts this in 2 Peter 1:3. He says, everything we could ever need for life and godliness has already been deposited in us by His divine power. Everything we need to bear fruit is inside of us. It's the power of the Holy Spirit that's ready and ready to be unleashed to help us to bear fruit. Everything we need, everything you need to bear fruit and to live a godly life is inside of you by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then Paul says in Ephesians 3, something very similar. Now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask, think, or imagine, according to His power that's at work within us. You see, it's the power of the Holy Spirit in us that does the work. So when the Holy Spirit brings something to your attention, say you're an impatient person or you're an angry person, and the Holy Spirit begins to bring this to your attention and deal with you about changing, listen to the Holy Spirit. Don't ignore Him. Ask Him to help you change, and then depend on His power working in you to help you change in that area of your life. Think about a good friend of mine named Roy. And Roy had been an addict since he was 13 years of age. Over a 20 or 25 year period of time, he had been addicted to drugs and alcohol. And he had done everything he could do to try to change himself. Roy came to meet Jesus several years ago, maybe 10 or 15 years ago. And when he met Jesus, he would regularly attend church. He would regularly read his Bible, but he just couldn't shake this addiction. And Roy told me that he was just tried everything possible, all the willpower, all the effort, and he just couldn't shake the addiction. He told me, though, one day he was sitting up in the risers here at church, and all of a sudden he heard somebody preaching, and they used one scripture, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit just awakened Roy's heart. And he said, "You know, Roy, this is your time to break that addiction." And did you know, Roy said that from that moment on, he began to depend on the power of the Holy Spirit. And from that moment on, he's never had that addiction anymore. Not addicted to alcohol, not addicted to drugs. And that's been over 13 years. And Roy still faithfully serves at this church. But here's the point. It was the power of the Holy Spirit that did something that Roy couldn't do by his own effort or his own willpower. You see, friends, it's the Holy Spirit that does the work on the inside of us. But now listen, even though the Holy Spirit does the work, we have to do our part. Let me say that again. Even though the Holy Spirit does the work, we have to do our part. We have to learn to resist our sinful nature, resist our flesh, and we need to learn to walk by the Spirit of God on the inside of us. It's something that we have to choose to do, and it does take effort on our part. Here's the way things happen. When we're born again, we were changed on the inside. There's a new birth. We're born again. Our spirit, which was dead, came to life. And the Holy Spirit came to live on the inside of us, to empower us, to lead us, to guide us, to teach us. But we still have our sinful nature. Everybody say amen to that. We still have our flesh to deal with. And there's this constant battle between our old sinful nature and our new spirit being. Part of growing up and maturing and bearing fruit is learning to resist the desires and the urges and the cravings of our sinful nature, and instead learning to walk by the Spirit of God that's on the inside of us. Paul says it like this in Galatians 5. He says, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are to do not whatever you want to do." You see, we have to learn to resist our sinful nature and walk by the Spirit. For example, somebody cuts you off in traffic. Your sinful nature rises up and says, "Get angry," and yell at them. But you know what? That still small voice on the inside said, "Let it go. Forgive them. Keep your peace." If we want to bear fruit, we have to learn to resist what our flesh wants and follow the Holy Spirit. Or let's say you're in a conflict with your spouse and you want to lash out with your words, but that still small voice on the inside says, "Keep your mouth shut, keep quiet." If we want to bear fruit, we have to learn to resist what our flesh wants and follow what the Holy Spirit says. Or everybody at the office is compromising and you're tempted to do the same, but that still small voice says, "Don't give in to that pressure. Live a life of excellence." See, again, we have to learn to resist our flesh and follow the promptings of the Holy Spirit, empowered by the Holy Spirit. Paul says it like this: we have to choose to crucify our sinful nature and live by the Spirit. Look in verse 24 and 25 of Galatians 5. "Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit." So listen, we need to learn to crucify our sinful nature. We need to learn to say no to our sinful nature, and we need to learn to keep in step with the Spirit of God. Sometimes, though, I don't know if it's like this for you, sometimes our sinful nature, our flesh, seems so strong, like a lion. It roars at us, demanding that we do whatever it says. And our spirit being seems so weak. It's like, how can I obey that still small voice in the face of this roaring lion of my flesh? Here's a key. Whatever you feed grows and gets stronger. Whatever you don't feed, whatever you starve, gets weaker. My dad used to illustrate it like this. If I were to ask you, if there was a fight between a full-grown lion and a Rottweiler puppy, who do you think would win? Well, that's a no-brainer. The lion would easily kill the puppy. But what if you did this? What if you fed that puppy the best food available for 6 months, and at the same time you starved the lion, you gave the lion just a little bit of food and a little bit of water, just enough to keep it alive? You know what? Now, after 6 months of doing that, who do you think would win the battle? The lion is now weak and can barely get his head off the ground, can't stand up anymore. The puppy is grown and is strong. Now the puppy could easily defeat the lion. In the same way, our sinful nature is like that roaring lion, and it feels so strong. And our new spirit being is like that baby puppy. It feels so weak. But remember, friends, whatever you feed grows and gets stronger, and whatever you starve gets weaker. Well, how do you feed your spirit? Feed your spirit with a relationship with Jesus, just like I've been talking about, being dependent on Him, putting Him first. Feed your spirit by reading God's Word every day. Feed your spirit by a strong prayer life. Feed your spirit by being involved in a good local church under the teaching and preaching of God's Word. Feed your spirit by surrounding yourself with strong believers who can call you up higher in your walk with the Lord. That's the way you feed your spirit, some of the ways. But by the same token, starve your sinful nature by not hanging around people that pull you down and try to get you to compromise. If you have a tendency to be angry, don't hang around angry people. If you have a tendency to gossip, don't hang around people that gossip. Starve your sinful nature by not watching that movie or not visiting that website. Starve your sinful nature by not putting yourself in situations that you know are going to tempt you. Starve your sinful nature by not giving in to anger or jealousy or gossip or saying whatever you want it to do. You see, friends, you have to remember, as you feed your spirit and starve your flesh, as you learn to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit inside of you, over time, you'll grow and mature and you'll bear fruit in your lives. Let me give you one more way that we can allow the Holy Spirit to produce fruit in our lives. Number four, realize that we all have blind spots. We all have blind spots. Each of us has blind spots, areas of our lives that need to be addressed or improved, areas where we need to come up higher, areas in our lives that are not bearing fruit. But for some reason, we are unaware of them. It's like blinders on a horse. We just can't see them. In Jesus' teaching about not judging others, listen to these words. He makes this statement. You must acknowledge your own blind spots and deal with them before you're able to deal with the blind spot of your friend. Point is, we have to acknowledge that we have blind spots. Several years ago, my three daughters and I were having a discussion in our kitchen. What started out as an innocent conversation very quickly got crosswise. Things got heated, and one of my daughters walked off in tears. It was obvious that she was upset with me, but I was totally clueless as to what had happened between us. After about an hour, I went up to her room and I tried to address the issue. And she told me that she was upset with me because I had been harsh and unkind to her. I couldn't believe my ears. You know what? There was no way in my mind that I had said anything or done anything that could have been construed as harsh or unkind. So I walked out of the room aggravated that I had been so wrongly accused. But then I remembered that my other two daughters had also witnessed this exchange. So I decided to go ask them what they thought, all the while wanting to prove my daughter wrong. When I went to the first daughter and asked her what happened, she quickly answered, "Dad, you were so unkind and harsh with her." Again, I couldn't believe my ears. So I went to the other daughter and I asked her the same question, and immediately she said, "Dad, you were so rude and harsh and unkind." She went on to say that my facial expression, my body language, my words all conveyed unkindness and rudeness. Finally, in humility, I accepted responsibility for what I'd done, and I sincerely apologized and asked for forgiveness from all three daughters. And now I ask the Holy Spirit to help me in that area, because it's a blind spot for me, to help me with my tone and my facial expressions, to help me with my body language and my words so that I reflect the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit in that area of my life. What a learning experience for me, though. I had to come face to face with the fact that this was a blind spot for me, something that I couldn't see. Then I begin to realize I need other people to help me see myself as I really am, not as I think I am, so that I can grow and I can bear fruit in those areas of my life. But I think about other parents like me in that moment who are harsh and unkind and don't even realize it. It's a blind spot for them. Or I think about it, husbands who are angry and they don't even realize it. Again, it's a blind spot. Or wives that are critical and they don't even realize it. It's a blind spot. You see, it really takes humility to admit that you may not be able to see yourself accurately. It takes humility to realize that you need others to help you see yourself as you truly are. I now use this phrase, "I think I'm right, but I may be wrong," to simply remind myself that I have blind spots and to keep myself humble with how I think that I see myself. I think I'm right, but I may be wrong. You know what? Because I realize sometimes I don't see myself as I truly am. But here's the point. If we really want to bear fruit, we have to realize that we may have blind spots that need to be addressed. Others can help us so that we can bear fruit of the Spirit in those areas of our lives. Here's my encouragement to you tonight. As we walk with Jesus, God wants us to grow and mature and bear fruit. He wants our lives to be transformed so that we look more and more like Jesus. How do we do that? We stay connected to the vine. We allow the Holy Spirit to do the work inside of us, but we do our part. We resist our sinful nature and we walk in the Spirit, and we remind ourselves that we do have blind spots. And we need to let others help us see those blind spots so that we can grow in that area. Friends, as you do that, I believe and declare we will bear much fruit. Jesus will be pleased. God will be glorified. And if you receive that, would you say amen right there in your home? Amen. God bless you. You know, we never like to close our service without giving people an opportunity to meet Jesus. You know what? Maybe even as I've talked, you've heard the voice of Jesus on the inside drawing you to Him. Maybe you've never known Jesus. You've never committed your life to Him. This is all new to you. You've been religious maybe, but you've never had a relationship like I've been talking about. Or maybe you knew the Lord at one time, but you've drifted away. The good news for you is this: God's running after you. His arms are always wide open. He wants to receive you back. If you want to make Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life for the very first time, or if you want to come back to Jesus for a new beginning, I'm just going to ask you to simply pray a prayer with me. Pray this prayer. Say, "Oh God, I know without Jesus I'm lost, but I don't want to be lost. I want to be saved. I ask you right now, forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Make me clean. I thank you that I'm now your child and that you're more than my God. You're my heavenly Father, and I'm going to serve you each and every day of my life." If you said that prayer, if you prayed that prayer, would you say this with me right now? Jesus is my Lord. We believe that tonight, as you prayed that prayer, you know what? You got born again. I would encourage you, as Joel does every weekend, get in a good Bible-based church so that you can grow, be under the teaching of a pastor, find a community of believers that you can be a part of. Do many of the things that I talked about tonight. Get a Bible, begin to read, begin to pray, begin to fellowship with other saints, grow in your walk with God so that you too can bear fruit. Friends, we love you. We miss you. We can't wait to see you again. October the 18th, we'll be back together. But until then, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause His face to shine upon you and give you His mercy and give you His peace. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you this weekend.